at the end of previous lecture, one doubt was asked. I will explain that first and then I will continue. As we all know, we are going to study this subject in 4 chapters. We are with chapter number 1, classification of all kinds of reactors and qualitative description of some of them, maybe 25 to 30 of that order. I must have explained to you about 6-7 of that, 7-8, the pressure energy type, both gas liquid, liquid liquid, and some solid liquid. The difficulty was at minimum fluidization velocity, drag equals gravity minus buoyancy. So, if we increase liquid velocity further, why the particles do not come out, why the bed expansion occurs? That was the difficulty. Right. I will repeat again, this is our say more or less minimum fluidization, and if you increase the further, then the bed expansion occurs. The level that you see here, that keeps on rising, the particle to particle distance increases, voidage increases, and last time I explained to you that eventually the pressure drop at, there is a minimum fluidization velocity, then pressure drop more or less remains constant, and at this point the particles start leaving the bed. You imagine, maybe I'll explain this in 2-3 steps. You imagine a particle, a single particle is released in a column having liquid. You know that initially some acceleration will occur and then it attains certain terminal settling velocity, right? So we are observing the particle being settled and it settles with terminal settling velocity. Now you imagine the liquid is flowing upwards equivalent to terminal settling velocity of particle, and now you release the particle. For an external observer, the particle will remain stationary. Let me repeat. In the first case, liquid is stationary, and particle is settling at terminal settling velocity. An external observer can see that the particle is settling. In the second case, the liquid is flowing upwards with a velocity equal to terminal settling velocity. Now you release the particle, and for an external observer, the particle looks stationary. right? Actually, the relative velocity between particle and liquid in both the cases is equal to terminal settling velocity, correct? No? The fact that in the second case liquid is flowing upwards and particle is stationary, the relative velocity between particle and liquid is still terminal settling velocity. If you increase velocity further, then only particle will move upwards and eventually it can leave the column, right? For any velocity less than terminal settling velocity, the particles cannot leave the column. Is that clear? Right. Now, coming to the doubt that we have minimum fluidization velocity is equal to the force balance is satisfied. Now, when liquid velocity is increased further, then why only bed expansion occurs? So, we have seen abundant number of times that the particles get self-supported when drag force equals force due to gravity minus force due to buoyancy. Now, in order to understand the next explanation, let us see what is the source of drag force, which I explained while I was trying to make you understand the lift force, but which I will repeat again. Whenever there is a relative velocity with respect to particle, are you able to read the backside? I think front students, they are unable to read. Is it better?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So, when either particle is settling or particle is stationary and liquid is moving up, as far as particle is concerned, suppose you yourself are a particle, correct? Then whether you settle or you are stationary and liquid is moving up, for you there is no difference, right? Now, imagine the case where there is liquid is flowing like this. On the surface of the particle, what I am explaining you, what is the source of drag force, right? On the surface of the particle, the velocity is zero. On the solid liquid interface or solid gas interface, the fluid velocity is zero, right? So, from the solid surface, the velocity increases, and if this is the column, eventually, then there is some upward liquid velocity very much away from the particle. So, liquid velocity increasing from the surface of the particle to some value means there is a velocity gradient. And velocity gradient results into momentum transfer. And the extent of momentum transfer, that is force per unit area, that is tau, is given by Newton's law, the minus mu times velocity gradient. All right. So the stress here is velocity gradient times viscosity. Stress here is velocity gradient everywhere. And such stress has two components, as I mentioned to you last time. That is, it has a vertical component and it has a horizontal component. So, whatever is tau w here, the tau w has both the components. In this particular case, the velocity profile on both the sides is identical, and therefore the radial component cancels with the radial component on the either side, and there is no net transverse force, there is no net radial force. What was happening in the boundary layer near the wall, that there was a velocity gradient, and near the wall stress was much higher than the stress away from the wall, and therefore the radial component was higher near the wall as compared to the radial component away from the wall, and therefore there was net force, which we said to be lift force. But for any particle in the bed like this, where flow is uniform on both the sides, identical, such radial components are same. What happens then? There is an axial component. Everywhere there is an axial component for the stress. Everywhere there is an axial component. When this axial component is integrated, which is in the reverse direction of the flow, then that will be, that is, this stress multiplied by local area, stress multiplied by local area, that is drag force, you integrate over the entire area, and that put together is drag force. Is clear? Yes? It's clear for one student. Drag force we have been calculating. I think you started from the third semester fluid flow, and your first example was laminar flow in pipeline, and you derived equation for parabolic velocity profile, and stress was maximum near the wall, zero at the center, and you derived pressure drop equation 32 mu L upon d square, correct? And stress at the wall was anyway there. You started with momentum equation, which you solved. I will explain once more. Whenever there is velocity gradient, there is a momentum transfer, right? So rate of momentum transfer per unit area, that is force per unit area, is called stress. And stress is given by Newton's law. The stress is equal to minus viscosity times velocity gradient. So the flux of momentum transfer, rate of momentum transfer per unit area, is equal to, if you take rate of mass transfer, the equation is same. Then there we take concentration gradient. But we call it, instead of Newton's law, we call it as Fick's law, and say that flux, the mass transferred per unit area, is equal to minus diffusivity times concentration gradient. Take Fourier's law. In the first case, we said about momentum transfer. In the second case, we said about mass transfer. Now, if you want heat transfer, the flux, the heat flux, is equal to minus conductivity times temperature gradient. This is how the momentum, heat, and mass transfer are described. One we call Newton's law, second we call it Fick's law, third we call it as Fourier's law, right? Now, the momentum transfer is occurring anyway whenever velocity gradient is there, and it is occurring at all the points on the sphere, right? So, the whatever is the stress, local stress because of velocity gradient multiplied by local area, is the drag force at that point, which has two components, the vertical component and horizontal component. And it is there everywhere on the particle. The fact that the flow is uniform on both the sides, the radial components cancel each other, and there is only a component in the reverse direction of the flow, is a drag force, it drags the particle in flowing upwards, and that is the drag force, which is equal to gravity minus buoyancy. What I am trying to answer is, the doubt was, when the liquid velocity is increased beyond the minimum fluidization, all of a sudden, immediately, why the particles do not leave the bed? Perhaps this was the difficulty, but even if this was not difficulty, this can be a difficulty, and I'm explaining something, right? I told you already at the beginning, particle can leave only when the liquid rise velocity or gas rise velocity exceeds the terminal settling velocity. This minimum fluidization velocity is much, much smaller than the terminal settling velocity of the particle. Why it happens? Because the force balance is satisfied at the minimum fluidization velocity itself. And why does it happen? The particles are touching each other. If particles are not there, then there is only superficial velocity. And when there are so many particles, then the voidage, the space through which the liquid can flow, for fixed bed it is only 0.4. So first thing is the true velocity, that is superficial velocity minus voidage, that increases. And the particles are close to each other, or there are plenty surfaces or plenty surface points at which the slip velocity is zero. So velocity gradients increase because of two reasons, because of reduction in voidage under fixed bed condition, the true velocity increases, and there are so many points around because particles are touching each other, the velocity gradients also increase. So the overall effect of the increase in velocity gradient means increase in local stress. Increasing local stress multiplied by local area, increase in the drag force. So at much lower superficial velocity, the equation of gravity minus buoyancy is equal to drag is satisfied. And what is that order of magnitude? The order of magnitude is, for if the particle is in laminar regime, that is Reynolds number is less than 1, then the minimum fluidization velocity is approximately 70 times less than the terminal settling velocity. If the flow is turbulent, the particle Reynolds number is more than 500, then it is about 10 times slower than the terminal settling velocity. If we express the actual superficial velocity upon terminal settling velocity, then this is equal to epsilon L raised to 4.8. if Reynolds number is less than 1. That is creeping flow regime. And if the flow is turbulent, so VL upon VS infinity is equal to epsilon L raised to 2.4 when the Reynolds number is greater than 500. If the Reynolds number is in between, these exponents are different, which you can see in the literature, and I can also tell you. But the point is, when the bed is fixed, the voidage is 0.4. So calculate 0.4 raised to 4.8. Point zero one two. So this becomes 0.012. Obviously, for epsilon L is equal to 0.4, and this is equal to Right, 0.111. For the same wattage, that is epsilon is equal to 0.4. So, 0.012, that is as compared to Vs infinity, take reciprocal of this, about 70. Point 0.012, 83, yeah. So, this means the minimum superficial velocity or velocity at minimum fluidization is 1.2% of terminal settling velocity, 1.2%. And I have already emphasized so many times, particle can leave the bed only when it is equal to terminal settling velocity. So, there is no question. It is only 1.2% when it is laminar flow or creeping flow, but if it is turbulent flow, then it is approximately 10%, 11% of the terminal settling velocity. Now, imagine the flow is turbulent and actual superficial velocity is 11% of the terminal settling velocity. Now, you increase the velocity, instead of 11%, make it 12%, right? So, 12% is obviously much less than terminal settling velocity. So, there is no question at what 12% or even 13% or 14% or even 50%, there is no question of particles leaving the bed. But what I need to explain to you, when it becomes 12%, how little expansion occurs and how the force balance of drag, gravity minus buoyancy, is satisfied when we increase the superficial velocity, and with the bed expansion, again force balance gets satisfied. You increase the velocity further, make it 20%, bed expands, but at that condition also again, the drag force is equal to gravity minus buoyancy. Increase it further, make it 90% wattage, then also gravity minus. You increase the wattage and make it 1. So, 1 raised to 4.8 is what? 1. So, superficial velocity becomes equal to terminal settling velocity, and at this condition, now particles can leave, right? So, under that condition, wattage is 1. What it indirectly means, there are no particles remaining in the bed. All of them are driven out under those conditions, correct? But what is to be explained now, if any velocity which is greater than minimum fluidization velocity, how the force balance gets satisfied, right? One thing which is very, very important, which I emphasized last time, for a given particle and given liquid, Fg is equal to volume of the particle multiplied by density of the particle multiplied by g, right? So, volume, density and g, you keep anywhere, there is no change which can occur. Similarly, what is the force due to buoyancy? Volume of the liquid equivalent to the particle multiplied by liquid density into g. So, the net gravity minus buoyancy, which is volume of the particle into g into density of solid minus density of liquid, this is constant from minimum fluidization, and let the bed expansion, the wattage can be 0.4, 0.5, 0.5, 0.55, 0.6, 0.7, let it be any wattage. At any wattage, if for the external observer, the particle appears to be stationary, then gravity minus buoyancy is equal to drag. So, when bed expansion is there, gravity minus buoyancy remains the same. Now, what should happen? The particles, they try to go away from each other. They try to go away from each other so that the true velocity increases, and the points at which, the velocity is zero, those points also go away from each other. So, since now the actual velocity is more, the points go away, but the stress, that remains the same. under those conditions. And overall drag force for the increased velocity remains the same because the particles, they adjust themselves by going away from each other. The true velocity and velocity gradient are in such a way that stresses remain the same, total drag force remains the same. So during the entire expansion, drag force has to remain the same. And that is mainly because for increased velocity, we need to keep the particles keep the same velocity gradient everywhere and drag force is the same. Is it clear? Not clear to anybody today. That is this equation you did not get, and then obviously this also you did not get. Yeah. At the moment, let us forget those two equations, right? Which I will explain again. The basic doubt was why bed expansion occurs. What is the reason for bed expansion? And that we need to explain on the basis of rate of momentum transfer, right? Fundamentally, we want to explain on the basis of momentum transfer. Have you understood? The only answer I want from you is yes or no. At minimum fluidization velocity, the velocity gradients around the particle multiplied by viscosity, the stresses and therefore drag force and integral drag force equals gravity minus buoyancy, and the particle is self-supported and we call that the particle is fluidized. Is this understood? 50%? Have you understood?
Yes, sir.
Then understood everything. Now let us see what happens later. We have understood this much? So at minimum fluidization velocity, there are velocity gradients everywhere on the particle surface. Multiplied by viscosity, multiplied by local area is drag force, and integral of the local drag force and total drag force becomes total drag force and is equal to gravity minus buoyancy. Right. Now you are increasing velocity. If the voidage would have remained the same, then the true velocity in the vicinity of the particle will increase. The stresses will increase and the drag force will be much more than gravity minus buoyancy. Correct. Now the balance is not satisfied. The particle cannot support on its own. The particle cannot remain stationary. Now we want to accommodate the fact that FD, the drag force, is now more than gravity minus buoyancy. Correct. How to do that? The particles try to move away from each other, give more space for liquid velocity to flow, and local true liquid velocities, they go down in such a way that again stresses on the particle, they remain the same. And drag force becomes equal to gravity minus buoyancy. For increased velocity, maintaining the drag force the same, maintaining stresses the same everywhere, means that velocity gradients have to remain the same. And for increase the velocity, the only way to do that is the particles must move away from each other. Understood? 20%. I think you have understood. Just once more. One who asked the question, has she understood? No, I should not identify the person. No, where is the problem? I can identify, no. Have you understood? Now, these are important things. Whenever we study mass transfer or heat transfer or momentum transfer, whether we are understanding, for students as intelligent as you, the derivations you can keep, you can mug and keep it total derivations for laminar, turbulent, fixed bed, fluidized bed, stir tanks, all derivations can be remembered. You are very smart. But that is not the principal objective when we study here. So we have understood the force balance at minimum fluidization velocity. When velocity increases, for keeping the same drag force is equal to gravity minus buoyancy, same stresses, same velocity gradients, the only way to give room for increased velocity is the particle should move away from each other, means bed expansion occurs, right? So if you increase the velocity further, more bed expansion occurs. If you increase the velocity further, more expansion occurs. Now such experiments have been done right from 1950 by large number of investigators in large number of universities, right? So what was done by a professor from University of Swansea called Richardson, what he did, he plotted log superficial velocity or log of superficial velocity and terminal setting velocity and voidage is observed. You have been able to observe the voidage, you have done this experiment. The total volume of solids is known, the total volume of bed expansion is known. We can calculate what is the fraction of solids within the bed, we know fraction of liquid within the bed. So the ratio, log of this ratio was plotted versus log of this ratio, and when Reynolds number is less than 1, the slope was observed experimentally to be 4.8, right? And when the Reynolds number of the particle was more than 500, that is the turbulent regime, then that exponent experimentally was observed to be 2.4. If there is any Reynolds number in between, then he has reported all the exponents, which of course lie between 4.8 and 2.4, right? And those relationships are known. So this was the explanation of the bed expansion. And if we go further, this is how it is shown. This is the minimum fluidization. The pressure drop practically remains the constant. The small rise is mainly because of friction on the wall. That is, pressure drop is equal to drag forces of all the particles put together divided by cross-sectional area. That is the pressure drop, which remains constant because the number of particles remain the same and drag force also remains the same in the entire range of bed expansion. But friction at the wall increases a little bit, so you see increase. But at now, when entrainment starts, when the superficial velocity becomes practically equal to the terminal settling velocity. So this is that graph. And this other graph, because of interlocking of the particles, this part I explained last time. But if we measure pressure drop versus velocity and get a maximum and go like this and go like this and reduce the velocity, now you don't return like this. Now interlocking doesn't happen. What happens is then the pressure drop follows this line, and when interlocking is removed, unless you don't shake the bed, again the pressure drop will follow versus velocity this line and not this line. Right? Okay, I think I will move further. I'll move further. This I explained to you last time, moving bed reactor, right? So in moving bed reactor, the solids are added at the top and because of consumption of solid phase, the bed goes down, and whatever level goes down, additional solid particles are added. The liquid or gas goes in, whatever is the reacting fluid, it goes from the bottom and then leaves at the top. The solids get dissolved in the liquid, so you get a solution at the top that is moving bed. This is another fixed bed used in ammonia oxidation for making nitric acid, where it is platinum, ruthenium, only wire gauze. So there are 2-3 gauzes which are kept in close to each other, then platinum. So these are also wire gauzes. Then there is a random packing. So this fixed bed is very thin, maybe 3-4 millimeters, not more than that. Since you might have studied nitric acid, you are in third year right now, no? So industrial engineering chemistry, when it is taught, that subject? First semester? Oh, third semester. So nitric acid you have already studied, sulfuric acid, nitric acid. So in nitric acid, ammonia is oxidized to give nitric oxides and nitrogen dioxide, and when that is absorbed in water, we get. So there the fixed bed is in this manner. So here again bed expansion has been shown, the fluidization, but this is solid liquid fluidized bed. And this is the experiment, how the people do. This setup was there in our laboratory, and then there was a camera here which could measure velocities at whenever we were taking photograph. The rate at which the photographs were taken, that rate itself was 1000, and at in every photograph at 1000 locations velocity was measured, right? And that is called particle image velocimetry. If anybody is interested, can we explain the principle of PIV if anybody comes to laboratory? All the equipment are physically there, right? Right. So you can see that, but that is not part of today's subject. How research is done, how we understand the details of drag force, and how does it change with the vicinity of the adjoining particles, and what is the source of turbulence, and what are the physical laws which govern the turbulence. For that purpose, such measurements are taken. But this is, and simply we can measure the bed expansion and again try to plot in this manner, but we will get the same plot. Next slide. But if the particles are non-spherical, and if they are totally new, or if there is some particle size distribution, then we should do this experiment all over again and try to decide our own exponent. This is a sort of an external loop reactor for solid liquid system. For gas liquid system, I explained you in detail the riser, the downcomer. For liquid liquid also, I explained to you. Now I am explaining it to you for solid liquid system or solid gas system. Try to attend to whatever I am saying. You have been attending, but I am giving special invitation now to whatever I am saying. Last time I little bit referred to chromatography. So if small impurities are to be removed, and very, very simple example is, if any organic liquid is to be made completely dry and moisture we should remain, there should not be any moisture. The well-known large-scale example is alcohol, ethyl alcohol. In ethyl alcohol, the azeotropic composition is approximately 8% water and 92% is alcohol. So whenever we distill alcohol, only azeotrope comes out, and now we need to remove water. And there are various ways of doing it by azeotropic distillation and extractive distillation. But the method which is very popular is adsorptive separation of alcohol. What is done? There are some particles, like say the simple is silica gel. You know that silica gel adsorbs water and it doesn't absorb ethyl alcohol. So we make a bed of silica gel, and from the bottom, under fixed bed condition, we pass the mixture of water and ethyl alcohol from the bottom. Right? Since silica gel has affinity for water, as soon as this mixture comes in contact with silica gel, the adsorption of water happens. Right? And when water adsorption is complete, and it is likely to get completed in a short distance from the bottom, and the bottom silica gel particles, they get saturated. But since we have selected a bed having height which is perhaps 10 times bigger or 50 times bigger than the saturation height. So this saturation height, have you studied adsorption?
Yes.
You have studied the breakthrough curve?
Yes.
You have studied breakthrough height?
Yes.
Very good. So whenever such mixture is passed at the bottom, equivalent to breakthrough curve, equivalent to breakthrough height, that much gets saturated. If we pass the mixture further, then there is lot of silica gel in the bed. Then the frontier of saturation of the bed moves further, and we are able to remove water from such a mixture till the entire bed gets saturated. Understood? Right. Now, this is practiced commercially. What in our laboratory, what we have done is like this, which you can see from this diagram, but let me explain. The adsorbent, the quantity that we need to provide in such a fixed bed is many, many times more than the breakthrough height. Correct? No? So in the breakthrough height, some quantity of water gets absorbed, and that breakthrough height keeps on moving up till it reaches the top, and now the bed is saturated. And when bed is saturated, now we try to remove water by increasing temperature, at which the adsorption equilibrium, the quantity of water that silica gel can retain with it, that decreases. When water goes away from the silica gel, it is now again ready to adsorb water. So there is an adsorption, there is a regeneration, then adsorption and regeneration. The point which I am emphasizing is, if we keep silica gel only equivalent to breakthrough curve, then it gets saturated immediately, and we will get some quantity of absolute alcohol. If we want that the bed should do the job for much longer time, we keep much more quantity of silica gel so that the breakthrough curve, the breakthrough height, it rises from the bottom up to the top, and we can use the bed till the entire bed is saturated. So in other words, if we want to use this as a method of separation, the actual quantity of adsorbent that we place inside is much more than the breakthrough quantity that is required. So imagine a case which is drawn here, that is water alcohol mixture is rising from here, and if there is a bed which is expanded bed, a fluidized bed, which is equivalent to a breakthrough height. So as the alcohol water mixture rises here, countercurrently particles are falling down, and the saturated particles which is now loaded with water, all those particles are taken to the another column in which another solvent which can take water away. So, in the riser column, the adsorbed water is separated completely, and now the mixture falls in the separation, the regenerated adsorbent falls back, and the quantity of adsorbent any time in the downcomer is equivalent to only breakthrough height. So, we need to use only 2 or 3% of the bed, which results into substantial reduction in the capital cost. Understood? Can we do the following? It is natural that you don't understand, right? Because you are a student and I am teacher, so that you don't understand is no surprise. Can you pick sentence or sentences where you have difficulty? You can say all, that is also possible. Let me explain once more, right? And one excellent method to understand is keep 100% attention to whatever teacher is saying. 100% attention, don't think of anything. After I explain, you introspect yourselves how many other things you thought about while I was explaining. You may be liking many other things, no, other than fluidized bed. But whenever you learn in the class, what you like the most is fluidized bed. Then only you will understand. Keep 100% attention. 100% is too much of expectation, but almost equivalent to that. So now you are attending. Are you attending? No, 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 you will not understand. Are you attending?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let us see the result. Okay. Stick to your decision, huh? Stick to your decision. In adsorptive separation, we try to remove whatever we want to remove by using the property of solid liquid equilibrium, right? In all separation processes, we use the same property. In liquid-liquid extraction, there is some liquid-liquid equilibrium. In solid dissolution, there is some other equilibrium. Adsorption, there is some other equilibrium, right? So I was explaining the case of removal of water from alcohol. The commercial alcohol is azeotropic alcohol and 8% is water, and whenever we want absolute alcohol, water is to be removed. Now, if we are passing 1 ton per hour of this mixture, 80 kgs is water because it is 8%, and typical adsorption equilibrium of silica gel is 10%, it can hold 10%. So, 800 kgs of silica gel will get saturated when we pass 1 ton. Now, if you want to pass another ton, then we need one more 100 kgs of silica gel. If you want third 100 ton, then 1 ton to be saturated. So, if you want to do this operation for one day at least, then we need silica gel 800 kilos multiplied by 24. Then you can operate it for 24 hours. Otherwise, what will happen? For 1 hour, you carry out, you regenerate, again adsorption, again regeneration. So, if regeneration takes 1 hour, then for every 1 hour of adsorption, we need to regenerate. So, capacity goes down. So, we try to operate for much longer time than 1 hour. So, if you are operating for one day, so 24 times 800, that much is required, right? But for if 1 ton per hour is capacity, actual silica gel required is 800. So if in the regenerated, manner, if silica gel is 800 kilograms, right from this point to this point, which is really regenerated. So here it is completely regenerated. As it falls down, particles fall down, they pick up water, and at the bottom, all of them are saturated, and now they go to the riser, all these particles. While they are rising, with the help of another solvent, the moisture is removed from the particles, and as the particles move at the top, all of them are regenerated, and the regenerated particles fall here, and now ready to absorb water from the alcohol. So only 800 kilograms, you keep on passing, not only for one day, you keep on passing for a week, for a month, for the entire year. The process of continuous removal of alcohol will happen in this manner. So that regeneration happens in a separate column, the adsorption occurs in one column, and the quantity of adsorbent which is used at any time is exactly equivalent to the quantity required for adsorbing whatever is to be absorbed from the inlet, in this case water. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yeah. So now secret, you have understood how to understand? Yeah. So let us try. Suppose you are attending, say, 40%, because plate efficiency in plate column is 45%, right? And then in some other equipment is some. So maybe if efficiency goes down to 40%, I'll explain three times so that it is more than two theoretical stages. I'll explain. But if you attend like this, then we will move faster. We'll move faster. See, I'm going to teach you irrespective of any number of lectures. I'm going to teach you everything what I want to teach you. That is not going to decrease. By let it be slow, let it be fast, let it be any rate. I will try, make an effort all the time that whatever I teach is understood by you. So we may meet on Saturdays, we may meet on whatever is the possibility with our mutual convenience, but we'll keep on engaging. I'm not going to reduce anything. I promised you that I'm going to solve in the class most complex example of multiphase reaction and that multiphase reactor. I'm going to do that. And I'm going to do 10 simpler problems than that. And I will do completely solve in the class here only. Or I will make a presentation and give that presentation to you so that you can understand separately. We'll arrive at that strategy. So this is like external loop airlift reactor for gas liquid. This is the external airlift reactor for, it is not airlift, it is now solid liquid system. And for solid liquid system, with the regeneration and adsorption happens in two separate columns, and the quantity of adsorbents. In some cases, the adsorbents are very expensive. You'll be surprised. The column which I mentioned last time, having 1,000 theoretical stages and 1 meter diameter, that particular adsorbent was 40,000 rupees per kilogram. 40,000 rupees per kilogram. And the total quantity inside was about 500 kilograms. So imagine the quantity required. It could operate because the breakthrough curve was moving from bottom to top. But if this type of equipment is used, we then need 20 times less or 10 times less, depending upon the breakthrough height, and then we save a lot of money. How we need to be competitive worldwide, right? The only way to remain competitive are only ways. There are various ways. The first way is whether we can reduce the capital cost, whether we can improve our innovative ability and design new type of equipment in such a way that your equipment cost is 5 times less, 10 times less as compared to anywhere in the world. The productivity of a person who works on the plant, that productivity is also more than the average of the world, right? Then whatever are the utility costs, say let it be steam or electricity, these are the two major utilities, whether we can generate in our plant innovatively so that the utility costs are also low. So in this manner, if we do the business, then only our business of our nation can pick up market in the world. Otherwise, what is the present condition? It is less than 1%. It is less than 1%. I must have told you last time, if you do business less than 1% in the chemical industry, which is leading, we are very good at chemical industry, very good. But very good as compared to electronics, where we do nothing. Therefore, chemical, we are good. Cell phones, any make, we don't make. TVs, do we make TVs? Do you know any brand which is popular? All cars, there are several Indian names, but the parts and technology is not Indian, which we buy from outside. So the entire business, chemical industry leads, which is 1%. Electronics, 0.01%. Mechanical, 0.05%. And then the plant-related medicines, that is Ayurvedic medicines, that also 1%. And China makes 30% business. And in Ayurvedic medicine, 2 years ago, they got Nobel Prize also. What we need to do as a citizen, concentrate on any problem. We can have a variety of subjects which we like, but we should like one at a time. If you like many subjects at a time, then there is no creativity. And if you have creativity, and this sentence which I said last time, which I'll say today, until I end this lecture series, I will say at least 10 more times. If you solve one problem which nation is facing and make it competitive as compared to anywhere in the world, you will be most happy person. You need not declare that you are a happy person. You will feel from within that you are a very happy person, right? And this is the condition which is very enjoyable, very enjoyable. Let it be any age. At any age, you feel very, very good from within. So obviously you must have got the message. What should be done? And all of you individually, I promise everybody is capable sitting in this class. Everybody is capable, can do this. Lot of persistence is required. All right? When we take up a problem, it doesn't get solved in the first attempt. There is no problem that which is so simple to be solved, all right? But no problem is impossible, all right? So coming back to this, so this technology is ready from our institute. So coming to the next slide. So this is now gas solid fluidization. I covered, we are with classification of reactors, pressure energy, kinetic energy, potential energy. The first one is the pressure energy. With pressure energy, we saw 4-5 reactors under gas liquid, same 4-5 for liquid, same may not be 4-5, but 3 at least for solid liquid, right? And now this is gas solid. So gas is a fluid, and then there is a minimum fluidization, minimum gas fluidization velocity at which the fluidization begins. Then there is a bed expansion. So here the bed expansion as shown is homogeneous, right? The voidage is uniform throughout as shown here. But in this case, when gas velocity is increased further as compared to solid liquid fluidization, something different happens. The gas, some of the gas flows in the form of bubbles in a mixture of solid liquid. Why it is called solid liquid fluidization? In the word fluidization, there is, I think, FLUID is there in fluidization. It's correct. It is there. So if you make two fluidized beds, one is 1 meter height and another is 10 meter height, and you connect to each other, both of them will come to 5 meters. So it has a property of fluid. And it attains the property of fluid only when the force balance of gravity minus buoyancy is equal to drag is satisfied. Otherwise, it cannot do. So it behaves like a fluid only when this balance is satisfied. Now, in such a fluid, if you pass extra gas, there is one possibility that further bed expansion should occur, but in solid gas fluidization, beyond a certain velocity, gas flows in the form of bubbles. So you have an emulsion, we don't call it as a liquid, we don't call it as a fluid, or whatever is that fluid, we call it as emulsion, solid liquid mixture. And that solid liquid mixture is typically, in majority of cases, has voidage equivalent to minimum fluidization velocity. And any extra gas over and above minimum fluidization flows in the form of bubbles. So this is the difference between solid liquid. But in solid liquid fluidization, there are some cases which are not more than, say, 10%. For the particles for which the settling velocity is very high, like, say, you take stainless steel particles, or you take lead particles, or gold particles, and try to fluidize, they behave some exactly similar to gas solid fluidization, and then you will see liquid bubbles. What is the definition of bubbles then? There is a region which is rising, which is devoid of particles. That will be liquid bubbles. So the lead particles has a high settling velocity, and when particle settles in gas, since gas density is less, the density difference is high, the settling velocities of solid particles is high. So generally, whenever particle settling velocities are high, then we get bed expansion in the form of the bubbles in a emulsion phase. Now that bed is expanded further, it is expanded further, and that was your difficulty. What is the pressure drop versus superficial velocity curve? And that was explained to you. So here the bed expansion occurs, the bed expansion has occurred till the last condition in the previous slide happens, and now then you attain velocity is equal to terminal settling velocity. I will stop here as far as the pressure energy equipment are considered. I have not taught you up till now design. How the equipment look like, that is the only thing, the qualitative description. So under pressure energy, I must have explained some 15, 16, some number of equipment under pressure energy. Now under kinetic energy, I will explain again some number, maybe 5, 10, 15, let us see. I hope that is the next subject. This is the gas liquid solid, one more. So in gas liquid solid, there are two possibilities. You take solid liquid fluidization in which you pass gas, right? So that is also gas liquid solid. Particles is a dispersed phase, bubbles is also a dispersed phase, and only liquid is continuous phase. But it is called a fluidized bed. But if you take a slurry of fine particles, where settling velocity of particles is relatively low and slurry is stable, then slurry comes in, slurry goes out, and now bubbles are formed in the slurry phase, and this is called slurry reactor. So when the solid phase remains in the reactor, it is called gas liquid solid fluidized bed. When solid liquid mixture in the form of slurry comes in, and in the form of slurry it goes out, then it is called a slurry reactor. And these are popular in variety of. I am going to distribute to you examples of industrial importance under each category, gas liquid, liquid, liquid. I will give you at least 30 examples under each category, right? So that, that you will get. So now next is our, this is one more equipment under pressure category, and these are called static mixers. What is the meaning of pressure category? The energy required. What is that energy does? It creates some velocity profiles inside. It creates turbulence inside, right? And turbulence is able to do the job that we want. I have not explained to you one particular example, which I am giving year after year, and this is now 46th year, where I am giving the same example again, right from the year one. I hope I have not given mixing of sugar in milk. Have I given that example to you? No. You are yet to drink sweet milk. I'm giving you that example. You will agree with me that sweet milk is a good idea, so we should attend 100%? Right, okay. You take a glass with milk inside and imagine the height of milk is about 10 centimeters. And now you put sugar inside. You can visibly see the layer of sugar at the bottom. Can you see? Yes? The glass is transparent, by the way. And it is desired that the sugar should dissolve, and we shall drink only sweet milk, not the undissolved at the beginning, and slowly the sweetness increases. That we don't want. Unless it becomes uniform, we are not going to drink. It is easy to understand, the sugar concentration is maximum at the bottom, and very close to the bottom the sugar concentration is zero, at least at time t is equal to zero. And at the top, anyway, it is zero. The sugar concentration is zero. So whenever velocity gradient is there, I said that momentum transfer will occur. And that is Newton's law. Whenever there is a concentration gradient, mass transfer will occur and Fick's law will be followed. And which is the flux of sugar is equal to minus diffusivity of sugar into concentration gradient. Correct? So this way, let me draw that, write that equation. This is glass, this is glass, and sugar is at the bottom. And there is a concentration gradient. So here, the mass flux is equal to minus diffusivity times the concentration gradient. imagine this axis is x-axis. So if this is the distance x, and the differential volume is dx. So how do we write the mass balance? The mass balance is in minus out is equal to accumulation. If you are attending 100% and then also you are capable of talking to each other, that is okay with me. So in is minus diffusivity dc by dx into say cross section. The cross section is S into S at x minus diffusivity into dc by dx into S at x plus dx, and accumulation means the volume is S into dx minus is equal to accumulation. So S into dx is the volume and the concentration, the change in concentration with respect to time. You have done this many, many times, divided by S dx throughout and take limit as S tending to 0. So you will get minus d2c, this will be a partial differential equation, c by dx square is equal to dc by dt. I realize that drinking milk is more attractive than solving this equation, right? But as a chemical engineer, we don't want to mix only sugar in milk. There will be so many examples. So better to understand how the mixing occurs, right? So this equation we try to solve, what this whenever we solve, we are going to get the concentration profiles within the glass. So at any time, from time t is equal to 0, you will get concentration here. At any time, you will get concentration here, you will get concentration here, you will get concentration everywhere. All right? Suppose we want 100% uniformity. Every drop of milk should have same concentration of sugar. What is the time required? Anyone? How much time is required? In a distillation column, if you want to separate anything from anything, and we want top product to be 100%, what is the height required? Infinite. So here for complete mixing, infinite time is required. Therefore, we define the time required for certain percentage of uniformity. So say, as far as milk is concerned, if it is 99% uniform, we won't be able to recognize whether it is 99% or 101%. We will drink very happily, correct, no? So then 99% mixing, then solving this equation, for 99%, the mixing time required, theta mix, is equal to 0.5 times length square divided by diffusivity. That is the solution of this equation. But this is for 99%. If you want, say, 95%, So instead of 0.5, we'll write 0.3. Right? So suppose we want 99% uniformity, sugar diffusivity in milk is of the order of 1 × 10⁻⁹. Length, I have already said, this is in meters square per second. And length of the glass, we have taken 0.1 meter. Calculate. How much time? (1400 hours). Tell me seconds. Tell me days. Some 40 days. 58 days. Is it acceptable? For anybody, is it acceptable? No. So in chemical engineering, whatever happens by molecular diffusion is not acceptable. Therefore, we provide energy, either in the form of pressure energy, potential energy, or kinetic energy, and provide it in such a way that instead of 58 days, whether it can happen in 5 seconds. You know how to do that. We put spoon inside and agitate it. When we agitate it, we supply kinetic energy to the liquid. And while spoon is rotating, is a flow. Let me draw a spoon where the end view is like this. Can you have a flat spoon? A flat spoon is possible, no? It's possible. Just for understanding purpose. So that spoon, while we are rotating, the flow now occurs across this immersed body. There is a front side and there is a back side while flow is occurring. On the back side, eddies are generated. There is a low pressure region and eddies are generated. And as the Reynolds number increases, or the rate at which we are agitating it increases, these eddies leave the spoon, and these eddies are free to move in the liquid. What is diffusivity? We know that molecules are never stationary. They are never stationary at any point of time. They move, and there is a certain mean free path, and on the molecular level there is a certain velocity. And if we use kinetic theory and derive the equation for diffusivity, the diffusivity is equal to mean free path multiplied by velocity on the molecular level, which comes equal to 1 × 10⁻⁹ for the sugar. So the molecules are moving randomly. Whatever is the mean free path and whatever is the velocity, average velocity, that gives. So these eddies, you can easily imagine, are the sizes of the order of spoon, which contains millions of molecules. And now these eddies are free to move inside. And now instead of diffusivity, molecular diffusivity, now I will write turbulent diffusivity or eddy diffusivity, or mixing occurring because of now eddy motion. Now eddies are also not stationary. They also move randomly. And whatever molecules can do, these eddies can do. Only complexity with eddies is, there is an eddy size distribution. whenever eddies are formed behind the spoon, these eddies break, they break further. So if the spoon size is 2 centimeters, 20 millimeters, the eddies which live are, say, for example, 10 millimeters, they break to 5 millimeters, to 2 millimeters, to 1 millimeter, to 500 microns, till 5 microns or 1 micron, and eventually they dissolve. So we have all size distribution of eddies, they move randomly. But the point is, whatever is moving randomly, it contains millions of molecules, and mixing happens faster. And now we have homogeneous milk with sugar in about 5 seconds or maximum 10 seconds. So the rates of momentum, heat and mass transfer, you imagine any equipment that you have studied, either distillation or absorption, we are never happy with molecular transport. We are never happy with Fick's law, Fourier's law, or Newton's law. That proportionality constant, diffusivity, which is molecular diffusivity, in all the cases, we want to replace it by eddy diffusivity for either heat, eddy diffusivity for mass, or eddy diffusivity for momentum. And that we convert the laminar flow into turbulent flow. The definition of laminar flow is all the transport occurs only because of molecular motion, that is called laminar flow. When the transport is taken over by turbulence, by eddy motion, then only there is a transition from laminar flow to turbulent flow, and under completely turbulent conditions, the transport occurring by molecular motion becomes negligible, and we call it as totally turbulent flow. See, you create and enhance any amount of turbulence. Again, on the molecular level, they are not stationary, and transport on molecular level will continue, right? But when you say you are now mixing with the help of spoon, and the mixing is complete in 10 seconds, so as compared to 58 days, the molecular way of transport is negligibly small. So though it is occurring simultaneously, it is small. One point though we need to remember, there is a certain eddy size which is much bigger than the molecular size. And whatever homogeneity occurs because of eddy diffusivity, that homogeneity occurs on the eddy level. And if the smallest eddy is, say, of 5 microns, then it will happen at 5 microns, right? But whenever chemical reaction has to happen in the reactor, this was simple mixing, then molecules need to come to each other, close to each other, and we need mixing up to molecular level, right? So what is done in practice? What is done in practice? That is by supplying energy, either in the form of potential energy, kinetic energy, or pressure energy, generate turbulence, try to attain fast uniformity up to eddy size. And for molecular uniformity, 99% uniformity, you need 0.5 L square upon D. Now, as compared to 10 centimeter height, you have been able to homogenize up to eddy level, that is say 10 microns. Now, instead of 10 centimeters, you put 10 microns here, the mixing time. So this way, the overall efficiency of mixing is enhanced by turbulence. There is one more method, and it is practiced, that is generate convection inside. What I will do, I'll reserve this explanation after a break. Okay, molecular motion and transport arising out of that is not acceptable. We deliberately generate turbulence and enhance the rates of transport. And there is one more way of enhancing transport, and that also is obtained by supplying energy. So everywhere we supply the energy, I must utter one more sentence, and so many times. so many times. I like to do many, many times. Suppose by supplying energy, the mixing enhances, right? How much to supply? How much to supply? If we supply certain quantity, agitate it for 10 seconds, there is a mixing and we drink the milk. If you rotate the spoon much faster, that is 1 per second or 10 times per second, maybe instead of 10 seconds you can mix it in 1 second, right? So for whatever energy you supply, you get rate of momentum transfer, heat transfer and mass transfer. So there is an expense associated with energy and you get the performance. Or for a certain level of performance, you need to supply energy or you have to spend the money. So every time you compare how much money we are spending and what is that we are getting. So while drinking milk, 10 seconds are good enough. There is not, it's a good engineering judgment that 10 seconds. But for some other process where polymerization is occurring, all right? So in polymerization, actual time required, it may be 9 days, 10 days, but it can be brought down to certain level, say 6 hours. But if you want to bring down further, the agitation required, the energy per unit mass will have to increase from 10 kilowatt per ton, 20 kilowatt per ton, 100 kilowatts per ton. So we are spending energy all the time. So every time we need to compare how much money we are spending and how much we are getting out of it. Suppose this itself is a reactor and every 10 seconds you mix and that is your operation. The mixed liquid, you put it somewhere else, all right? And you do it in a day, the total mixed liquid with sugar, there will be certain quantity, all right? You now reduce the rate of agitation and instead of 10 seconds, it takes 30 seconds. Now per day, the number of batches will be less, but the energy supplied is less. You enhance the energy, make it in 2 seconds, make it in 1 second, and then you will get certain quantity. So what is the productivity for a given energy that you compare? By selling that much milk, how much profit you are going to get, and by supplying that much energy, how much money you have given for energy, this we compare all the time. I've told you only one thing. So we compare all the time, what are the inputs? It may be in the form of raw material. It may be in the form of other utilities. Maybe in the form of energy. It may be in the form of the manpower. It may be in the form of the land cost. It may be in the form of the interest that we pay to the bank. But everywhere, every time, we compare what is the total input which is going in inside the manufacturer and what is that profit we are getting, right? But whatever I have said just now, I'm going to say this many more times, okay? We'll meet after a break.